Welcome to the next instalment of our 2020 virtual salon series. This is a program of music by Henry Purcell, perhaps England's greatest composer ever, although there are a few contenders perhaps against that, maybe Byrd, maybe Benjamin Britten if you're into that, but certainly Purcell was one of the greats, like Mozart in Austria. Died around the same age as Mozart, very young. He was 35, 36. This programme is entitled Something Old and Something New, brackets, perhaps something borrowed as well. And it's a holiday gift for our patrons and supporters, so welcome to you all. And it's featuring our wonderful violinists, KATHERINE KYME and Noah STRICK, Maria CASWELL and Aaron WESTMAN on violas, William SKEEN on viola da gamba and KATHERINE HEATER on harpsichord. And we begin today's programme with a Fantasia by Purcell. Now, he wrote these in 15 Fantasias in a sort of fit of creative energy in 1680. They just appeared and they are something old. The fad for fantasies was very much an Elizabethan thing. Loads and loads of keyboard fantasies and viol fantasies for viol consort. Purcell wrote these in 1680 when the viol consort was pretty much dead. So it's a harking back to the old days of this English penchant for counterpoint, dense counterpoint, which was so beloved by Charles I, the king before Cromwell came and chopped his head off. Purcell, of course, was born into the New World, but more of that later. And first, you're going to hear this beautiful Fantasy number 11 in G major, written by Purcell, full of fantastic counterpoint.
Thank you.
So that was something old, these wonderful, amazing fantasies by Henry Purcell, of which you've just heard one example. I do urge you, if you don't know them, to go and listen to the rest. They are utterly delicious and quite a meal for the ears. But this, the new style that was coming in after Cromwell had gone away and Charles II had returned from his cousin Louis XIV's place in France, there were lots of influences flying around in England at this point. And these trio sonatas, that was very much an Italian form written at the beginning of the, which started at the beginning of the 17th century, for two violins, sometimes cello, and in this case with Purcell, two violins, viola da gamba, so keeping a link with the old consort music, and keyboard. And you'll hear two trio sonatas. The first trio sonata in A major is from the first collection of trio sonatas which Purcell wrote, which was published in 1683. 12 of them, sonatas of three parts, which means there were two violin parts and one for the bass, the viola da gamba and the organ. And this is a very good example of this early Italian trio sonata style, not by Corelli, but by composers like Collista, if you've heard of him. So it was a sort of ripening idea through the 17th century of the trio sonata, which found its apotheosis in Corelli at the beginning of the 18th century. So this is a beautiful trio sonata in A major with a very Italianate feel, but there's still a little bit of that dense English counterpoint which Purcell could never quite rid himself of. And after that we'll hear the most glorious trio sonata in G minor from the next collection of trio sonatas, which was published for Purcell's wife, Frances, after he died. This was published in 1697, so 2 years after Purcell had died. And this is an extraordinary trio sonata because, unlike the A major, which is in movements, you can call it, it's sort of in sections and movements, this is one movement, and it's a Chaconne in G minor, and that's a great key for Purcell. If you know Dido's Lament, the great Chaconne for strings in G minor, it's one of the most glorious keys that Purcell used to work in. And one of the great genius things that Purcell could do was write over ground basses. And this is a Chaconne ground bass, and the two violins weave the most extraordinary textures over this beautiful ground bass in G minor, and it's so beautifully expressive. It's Italian, yet it is very, very, very English. So two trio sonatas, a trio sonata in A major and a trio sonata in G minor by Purcell. Thank you. the most wonderful music, so rich and passionate in a very English way. We can be passionate, I believe, the English. So it's a well-kept secret. So now moving on to something new. As I mentioned, when Charles II came back to England and was restored to the throne in 1660, he brought with him tastes from the French court of Louis XIV. Charles II hated the old English counterpoint that you heard so clearly in the fantasy at the beginning of the programme. He really loathed it, unlike his predecessor Charles I. He loved something you could tap your foot to, which is something that, again, he inherited from the style of music in Louis XIV's court, dance music, French dance music. And this was something which made its way swiftly into the English music that was being written for Charles II and in the country after the Restoration in 1660. And Purcell absorbed the new style of music, although still kept quite a lot of counterpoint in his music, but could provide music that people could tap their foot to. And towards the end of his life, in 1692, Purcell created The Fairy Queen, which was a massive sort of Broadway spectacular, massive show, entertainment, which in its entirety must have lasted 4 or 5 hours. And he provided fantastic music, not only vocal music, but a great deal of instrumental music for this production. And I've put together a little suite of some of my favourite bits from this extraordinary creation. And you'll hear, there's lots of stuff you can really tap your foot to. We start with an air, which is very, very, very gorgeous opening gambit, a rondeau, which is with a repeated refrain, a very English hornpipe. Then if you all know the Fairy Queen, you'll know If Love's a Sweet Passion, a great soprano song. This is the instrumental prelude to that song. Again, which has got, it's a melody, but it has wonderful, wonderful counterpoint for the inner voices. And then a couple of dances. A dance for the fairies and dance for the green men, which are sort of primitives, if you like. Then another hornpipe, and we finish the suite with a glorious chaconne. Nothing like the G minor chaconne that Purcell wrote earlier, which is much more dense polyphony and counterpoint again. This is really foot-tapping stuff, which would have made Charles II extremely happy. So here's a suite from Purcell's Fairy Queen. What an uplifting and fabulous way to end the programme and take us into a new year, hopefully, with great optimism and joy, which this music has in abundance. So thank you for joining us. Happy holidays. Keep safe. Be well. Look forward to next year. We will be providing much more virtual stuff for you to wrap your ears and eyes around, if you can wrap eyes around, I don't know. So stay tuned, keep an eye on what's coming, and we will see you as soon as possible. So very best wishes for the new year. Happy New Year, and keep well.
Hope you enjoyed the show. Have a wonderful holiday season, and cheers.
Season's greetings, one and all. Wishing everybody a healthy, happy 2021.
Hey everyone, it's Noah. Thanks for watching. Happy holidays and stay safe.
Happy holidays from Katie
and Bill.
Thanks for your support, everyone, and happy holidays.